Samuel Jasper. I'm a psychology student here at Adams State, and I'm going to be presenting to you today on the impact of cultural dimensions on psychological help seeking. So to start off, just a quick overview. This project is going to focus on how six different dimensions of culture affect attitudes towards psychological help seeking and barriers towards care. And it's across 10 different countries and six different continents. So the countries are the US, the UK, Turkey, South Africa, Egypt, Brazil, Argentina, India, Japan, and Australia. So let's get right into definitions. First, culture. How do we define it? Well, first, it's acquired, typically through teachings, symbols, and social learning, which is really describing how we see the people in our environment and we pick up those behaviors and we copy them. So also, it's shared by a group of people and typically generationally, and it's passed down this way through generations as well. And this starts to create norms, which are those consistent patterns of thinking, feeling, and reacting that you see in a culture. So, it also ties into values, which are the various ideas, beliefs, and attitudes that really shape a perspective and outlook on the world. So all of these things combine, and way more, I'm sure you guys can think of some, that make culture, which is a pretty abstract variable. So how do we measure that? Well, we decided to use Hofstede's theories of cultural dimensions, which states that on a national level, we're looking at six key dimensions that typically show a lot of variation between cultures. So let's start explaining those. The first is the power distance index. And this dimension really explains how a country both perceives and distributes power. And what I mean by that is that, say a country is high in power distance. To them, how power is distributed is very important. And also, it tends to be that a lot of people are at the bottom, while a few people are at the top. So it's not as equally distributed when you compare it to a low power distance country, where it's a lot more equally distributed, and power isn't seen as such an important thing. You can kind of see this in our graph and our sample size. To kind of hit home, we can relate with the US, right? We have a lot of people at the bottom and a few people at the top with a lot of power and control. So we score pretty high on power distance. So our next dimension is the individualism collectivism. And this really focuses on, does a culture place emphasis on group achievement or individual success? And this has been researched a lot because it has a lot of good applications within education in the workplace. Obviously, how you work in a team and your variable there is important. So you can see within our data that we have our collectivist countries, which are typical with some of other Hofstede's other research. But usually the US is all the way on this individualistic side. So that might be a bit of a sampling due to convenient sampling. So just keep that in mind. Our third dimension is masculinity versus femininity, which isn't describing a gender role for a nation, but rather how that nation perceives gender roles and kind of how they expect them to be followed. So in a masculine society, those gender roles are laid out very clearly, and it's a pretty good expectation that you should follow it. In contrast, a feminine society, that's a lot more fluid. There's not as many expectations, and it's not so important that you stay within your given set of rules. And you can see that our data pretty well reflects this. You see up here, like in Australia, that makes sense that they're probably a pretty gender fluid society compared to maybe India or South Africa, where the same things would just not be okay. Our fourth dimension is the uncertainty avoidance index, and this relates to how a culture deals with negative feelings like mistrust, uncertainty, and anxiety. And keep in mind, this also relates to how much tension is going on in that culture right now. Are they in a time of war or conflict? Because that'll really up uncertainty avoidance index, because more negative feelings come along with national scale problems. So in our data, you can kind of see this too. But again, this one is kind of a hard one to decide if our data fully matches due to probably some convenient sampling. The fifth dimension is long-term orientation versus short-term orientation, and this is really trying to describe how a culture deals with change. So in a long-term orientation, you're preparing for the future. Your outlook is on how can I be successful in the steps to come. In comparison to a short-term orientation, where you want to live in the moment and you want to embrace the opportunities that are given to you at that time. So, and our data reflects this, I believe, because in the US, right, we have this attitude of live in the moment, get your opportunities when they're there, as compared to maybe some of these countries here where there might be a little more planning that needs to go in to do you want to go to school, do you want to move up the economic ladder. So our final dimension is indulgence versus restraint. And this dimension is relatively new. It was actually added in 2013, so they're still conducting research on it. But it's really trying to describe a culture's perspective on free will. And should you embrace your wants and your indulgences, or should you be more restrained and conservative and patient about what you want? And our data reflects this and also reflects the fact that religiosity plays a role in this. Because if you see here in our very restrained countries, like India and Japan, Buddhism and Hinduism are very common in the area, and they place a lot of value on things like restraining to just what you need. So our data also reflects this. So to switch gears real quick, attitudes towards psychological help seeking. So this is really just an attitude towards any type of behavior for getting help for a psychological disorder or distress. And this is important because mental health disorders are one of the leading causes of disease, not just in our country, but internationally. And the high amounts of stigma that we see in our country are also an international issue. It's not just here. So it's important to kind of know the differences in attitudes so we can address them. Because already research has shown that in ethnicity, gender, and current psychological distress, so like you would be more positive to getting psychological help if you're having a breakdown, maybe opposed to if you're having a bad day. Or help-seeking history, if you have help-seeking history, did it go good, did it go bad? That'll definitely influence your attitude. And also mental health literacy, which is a really important variable when we're talking about international research, because not every culture even has a word for depression, for anxiety. So these things just aren't as streamlined as we may think here in the US. So building that literacy in a way other cultures can understand is important. But another thing we have to consider is potential barriers. And barriers can be both perceived, which would kind of relate to something cognitive, like I can't get help because it won't really help me. Getting help isn't worth my time. And just making cognitive kind of excuses in that way. However, there can also be actual barriers that should be noted. Both geographical, so rural areas, we all even know here, there are less mental health services in rural areas as opposed to urbanized areas. But we also have financial and personal reasons that tie in. Mental health services can be expensive, and the variation on that internationally is crazy. So, but overall, again, prior research has shown that typically individuals who are male, married, less educated, which feeds into that mental health literacy piece, of low socioeconomic status, and who are elderly also experience more barriers on average. So, keeping that in mind, all of that, we formed three key hypotheses. We suspected first that countries with a higher power distance index would experience more barriers to care and have a more negative attitude when it's approaching psychological help seeking. And we thought that this might be because typically, when you have really stratified power and a very big respect for power, therapists and counselors went through a lot of school. They're kind of up there on that power chain, so it would be really viewed as inappropriate to air your dirty laundry and your problems to them. So, second, we thought that collectivistic cultures would probably have more negative attitudes towards help seeking, along with experiencing more barriers. And this is somewhat similar to power distance, but in the sense that in a collectivistic culture, it's viewed as problems like this should be kept in the family. You don't really want them to go out and put a bad name on your family name because your kin is very important to you. So our third hypothesis was that feminine countries would have a more positive attitude and experience less barriers to care. And this is because since gender roles are more fluid, it would especially affect men because it's less of that stereotype of you have to be tough, you have to be assertive. Without that expectation, it's more likely that men in these cultures would seek help. So, how did we evaluate this? So first we conducted a survey through SurveyGizmo, which is an online format. We had 500 total participants across 10 different countries, so 50 participants per country. And that's a bit of what that looks like. So we also uploaded the project to Open Science Framework, which is a software that helps organize projects but also encourages open data practices. And that's a bit of what that looks like. And of course, data was entered in Excel and SPSS, and we analyzed it through there. So to analyze our data and to see how all of Hofstede's dimensions correlated with attitudes and then correlated with barriers, we conducted independent samples t-tests. And what we were really trying to look at is the extremes here. So what are the countries that are the most on either end, and how does their score in Hofstede's dimension account for the variability in their attitudes and barriers when seeking psychological help? And you can kind of see this methodology here in one of my examples for a non-significant result, is we took the three countries with the shortest orientation, compared them with the three countries with the longest orientation, and through this methodology, we found four significant results. Our first was with power distance index, and we found, in agreement with our hypothesis, that countries with a higher power distance index experienced more barriers to care. And this can be represented by the graph here. The mean scores for very low PDI are in blue, while the mean scores for very high PDI are in red. And however, it is important to note that contrary to our hypothesis, we did not see differences in attitudes across power distance index. Our second result was with individualism and collectivism. We found that collectivistic countries actually had more positive attitudes towards help-seeking than their individualistic counterpart. And this was contrary to our hypothesis. And we suspect this could be due to some of the convenient sampling, like I had mentioned a bit through the presentation. It's important to note that to participate in our survey, you had to have a computer, and you had to be computer literate enough to take the survey. And this may not be completely representative of the country as a whole, just because that's not realistic in all cultures for there to be computer access. So that might be a potential explanation for our contrast in results. Third, we found that actually more masculine countries had a more positive attitude towards help seeking than feminine countries. And this was contrary to our hypothesis, as we also didn't find any differences in barriers to care. And again, we really do suspect this is due to a convenient sampling. And also, there was a very big differential between genders in our sample on this one. So we think that there just needs to be more sampling done here to kind of have our results match more with what we suspected. So our fourth result was the uncertainty avoidance index. And although we didn't have a hypothesis for this, we found that countries with a higher uncertainty avoidance index had more positive attitudes towards help seeking when compared to countries with a low uncertainty avoidance index. And although we didn't suspect this initially, it makes sense in retrospect, because if you're experiencing more anxiety and more negative feelings, you're going to probably have a more positive attitude towards getting help for those things, because there's probably some more extreme things going on where you might need it more. So, and that can be reflected in the mean scores again here. So, all right. So in conclusion, although a lot of our expectations were contrary to our results, it's probably due to the convenient sampling. And with more sampling, we really think that this could be an interesting technique to look at for predicting help seeking. Using Hofstede's cultural dimensions is not something that's been done before in accordance with attitudes and barriers for help seeking. So we think that if there's continued research, we could definitely have some more predictable results and more consistent results with what Hofstede has shown in the past. And especially when looking at power distance index, individualism, collectivism, masculinity, femininity, and uncertainty avoidance index. Because we did find significant results, it would be interesting to evaluate those more and really see where they go. But either way, it's important for knowledge of cultural differences for anyone. This can just help really understanding people and where they're coming from, and it can also be really helpful to clinicians to really just provide accurate care because the population we're treating is getting more and more diverse every day. So it's important to be able to give the population what they need to succeed. So I would just like to acknowledge Dr. Dembski here as my mentor. None of this would have been possible without him, so I just want to say a big thank you to him. And also for ASNF and the Campus Impact Fund grant, they helped fund this project, so I appreciate them as well. Does anyone have any questions?
What's the scale for your dependent variable?
The scale for my dependent variable was from a 0 to 3 on both the attitudes and behavior scale.
Okay, and the means is like a lot more around what, 1.5, 1.6?
Yeah. Yeah, typically is what we found.
How, so I guess I have a view of what counseling is and what like some psychological help is like. Mm-hmm. Is that consistent across countries or how is counseling or psychological intervention done in different countries?
Honestly, that's a really good question. So it is really variable, and that can also kind of account for some of our results, especially looking at collectivism and individualism, because there are countries that embrace more naturopathic methods and more like group healer methods. And you see that in collectivistic countries too, because you have that idea of a close-knit kin, where a traditional healer might be more invitable to them in a sense. So you are kind of seeing this variation in, although we have this very westernized view of psychology here, with therapy and counseling. It's not the same everywhere, but there are mental health practices everywhere. So, yeah, I think it does really vary. Yes?
My question is very related to my question. I'm a visiting professor from Mexico, School of Business, and we also review these concepts and classes of organizational behavior, and the country has a very high
Yeah, that definitely is a very interesting comment there because you're definitely right. And I had read up on some really good research looking at how especially collectivistic countries and countries that have rural areas and less resources are embracing less schooling needed for certifications, just doing other methods to help expand where they can go. And also just looking at, like you said, some naturopathic remedies and things that are just there to use the resources they have. So I think that's a really great comment because you're totally right, and it was really interesting to read about those variables and how they really contribute to help seeking and kind of looking at how what we can do, you know, to help people out and be more accurate in that.
there ever been like a correlation to like maybe prison population as well?
That's an interesting question. I actually haven't seen anything like that. That's a good question. I'll have to look into that because I haven't looked at it. But
males are in jail that are mentally ill and they've never received help. And, and instead of like acting out in like maybe feminine ways, they act out in like this appropriate masculine way of like violence or like something, and they end up in prison. So maybe there could be a correlation between like how culture treats these mentally ill people and does it force them into maybe crime.
Yeah, there definitely is a lot of variation across cultures on how mental health is treated and how mental illness is handled, and you definitely see that. I mean, there are some that have institutions like prisons, there are some that have outreach centers. It really just depends on where you're at, and it's such a wide variation when doing international research, so that's really just part of it. You get to learn a lot.